Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Wednesday worship here at SPSJ in Hereford. It's really great to have you joining us. A special welcome if you're joining us for the first time. Today is in the middle of Fair Trade Fortnight, and so we are going to spend the whole of today thinking about global issues, and particularly around environmental issues and climate change today. So we have Peter Strevens, who heads up our Eco Church team here at SPSJ, who's going to be speaking to us on this topic. And his wife, Janet, will be leading us in some prayers as well. And in between that, there will be some songs for us to join in with or to sit and reflect on what's been said. So I'm going to open our service now with our first reading, which is taken from Psalm 104. Praise the Lord, my soul. Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendour and majesty. He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the watery depths as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. But at your rebuke, the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary that they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the sky nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The land is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for people to cultivate, bringing forth food from the earth. Wine that gladdens human hearts, oil to make their faces shine, and bread that sustains their hearts. How many are your works, Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And we're going to, in our first song now, continue to think about all the majestic works of God and this wonderful hymn, O Lord my God, how great thou art.
Thank you. and it's good to be with you again to share in this Wednesday worship. Now, Lent is traditionally a time for reflection, and this morning I want to spend a little time reflecting on the environment, which is also the subject that we'll be picking up later this morning in our Lent lunch together. And it's appropriate too, because as I'm recording this, it's a beautifully sunny day, and it's clear that spring is in the air, bursting forth with new life, even though there's still a nip in the air. And I've even got my fully environmentally friendly and fully recyclable red nose to show you. Look, there you go. Look at that. And this Lent, I don't want you to give up anything. What I want to encourage you to do as part of your Lenten journey is actually to do something. Our Anglican Church has signed up to the five marks of mission, and they can be summarised with five T's: to tell and proclaim the good news of Jesus, to teach and grow Christians into maturity, to tend, responding to all human need in service, to transform, challenging unjust structures, opposing violence and working for peace and reconciliation, and to treasure our world and its environment, striving to safeguard the integrity of creation and sustaining and renewing the life of the earth. So caring for our world is not just a trendy add-on. It's an integral part of the work to build the kingdom of God. And who can doubt that our world is in trouble? The planet is warming up. Pollution of our skies and seas is slowly killing us. The sea ice is melting and sea levels are rising. We've seen unprecedented wildfires in Australia and America, causing immense damage and danger to life. And big storms causing major floods throughout the world, and in other places, long droughts. We've even seen it here in sleepy old Hereford. Yes, we've seen too the effects of climate change and the damage it does. The Environmental Agency manager for Hereford said last week, since records began, we have had 14 floods of over 5 metres in Hereford. 6 have been since 2000. 4 have been in the last 18 months. And 2 have been in the last month. So we are affected too. There's the plastics pollution of our seas. There's the loss of habitat and the destruction of rainforests, all leading to a massive loss of species. And I could go on and on and on. And we know too that this has a disproportionate effect and impact on the poor in developing countries, who by and large contribute very little to the problem. It's a scandal and it's an outrage, and something I'm sure that is close to God's heart, who, when he created the world, the heavens and the earth, saw that it was good. More than that, saw that it was very good. Our climate scientists tell us that if we do not act and act quickly, we're heading not just for climate change, but climate catastrophe. We are in a climate crisis. So what's our response? What can you do? What can I do about all this? We could just sit back and wring our hands in despair and take the view that the problem is too big, that anything we can do as individuals can't make a difference. It's up to others. The problem is just too big. But I believe we can, and I think we can do so in a number of ways. I've got something written in the front of my Bible that I refer to regularly. It says, I utterly refuse to gratify the devil by being downhearted. The problems are huge and they're complex. But if we as individuals, as communities, corporately, nationally, internationally, get our act together and get our act together quickly, we can go a long way to cracking this problem. I was encouraged 5 years ago to be in Paris when 192 nations signed up to the Paris Agreement to work towards the limitation of the rise in global temperatures. I was deeply saddened when America dropped out, but overjoyed when they recently rejoined. I'm encouraged by the delayed COP26 meeting to be held in Glasgow in November, which the UK is hosting and leading, an enormous opportunity for us. I'm encouraged that national farming policies are moving towards environmental land management. It's not all plain sailing by any means, but Brexit does also present opportunities for greener policies. I've been a chartered accountant for over 50 years, and I'm encouraged to see in my profession things that I've never seen before. The raising of a new corporate awareness and the need for companies to report on their sustainability for the future and reporting on their carbon footprint. I've never seen that before. I'm encouraged to see the work of our scientists and what they're doing on new and greener and renewable technologies. I'm encouraged that there's pressure for a greener and more sustainable route to recovery after this awful pandemic. No, I am not downhearted, but we need to act, and we need to act quickly. But what difference can you and I make? We won't be able to solve all the problems, but we can contribute to the solution. So what can we do? What can you do and what can I do? I think this works on a number of levels. There's the individual response. We can look at how we can make positive and eco-friendly choices about our lifestyles, about our purchases, our food miles, the packaging we use, our energy use, waste, refuse and recycling, our water use, our transport, our online purchasing involving all those van deliveries. We can all do that. What about using climate stewards or something similar to audit your household personal carbon footprint and then consider donating to offset it? And those donations will go towards planting trees in South America and Nepal and Africa, and towards water filters and fuel-efficient cookers, similar to those that we raise money for to send to Rwanda. I really like Climate Stewards' approach. It's not do what you like, carry on as normal, because you can salve your conscience by donating an offset. No, what they say is reduce what you can, offset the rest. Go on, let me challenge you today. Don't delay. Do something today. And just in case you're wondering, yes, we've done our audit and our offset for 2020. And then there's the community and corporate response. There are things going on in our wider community that you can be part of. Look out for the resumption of those community recycling opportunities, for instance. And if you live in the St. James and Bartonshire area, there are things that you can get involved in there and take an interest in. Go on, get involved. Take an interest. Be informed. We already are as a church, but more voices are needed. And we are involved at the church community level through the Eco Church movement, which challenges us all as a church to think about our worship, our land and buildings, our community involvement, our corporate and individual lifestyles, all in a more eco-friendly way. But the problems are bigger, and they're bigger than we can solve alone or even in our community. We need to bring pressure to bear on our politicians nationally and internationally. Let me encourage you to sign up to Climate Coalition, a pressure group of individuals and organisations that include people like Tear Fund and Christian Aid and CAFORD. And sign up to Arosha UK so that you can be better informed. These problems, if we are to get carbon neutral by 2050, will involve our politicians, bankers, investors, scientists, manufacturers, consumers, everyone. Campaigns are only as strong and as effective as the number of people that support them. So sign up and be involved and be informed. You owe it to your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. And that's why I'm so thrilled that so many young people want to be involved in this whole environmental and green movement. And that's why the meeting in Glasgow in November is so critical, because it involves international issues as well. And we know that there are international problems with countries like China and India. And I hope to be part of that meeting in Glasgow in some small way with the friends that I walked to Paris with 5 years ago. So do pray for it. Do be praying for it regularly. Be informed about it, because ultimately we're all part of it and in this together. You see, at the end of the day, our stewardship and our responsibility for our world is a kingdom issue. In Paul's most eloquent summary of the gospel, which we read earlier from Colossians chapter 1, he proclaims that all things in the universe have been created by Christ, and are being sustained by Christ, and will be reconciled to God by Christ through the blood of the cross. This is the absolutely breathtaking universal scope of the gospel. The Christians in Colossae could stand firm in their faith, could stand firm in their hope, because their salvation was bound up with a gospel that was cosmic in its scope, spanning space and time. The gospel is good news for all creation. Caring for creation is a gospel issue. It's kingdom building work. And I want to say to everyone who says that this is all just a blip and it will go away and it's nothing to worry about, I hope you're right. But everything being suggested must be good anyway and can't do any harm, so it can't be wrong, can it? Let me close by quoting Pope Francis, not something I often do in sermons. In the Pope's encyclical Laudato Si, written just before the Paris conference, he says in the chapter about ecological and spiritual education, "All is not lost. Human beings, while capable of the worst, are also capable of choosing again what is good and making a new start. So while sometimes by what I see and hear and the enormity of the problem, it would be easy to be depressed, I do have hope because I refuse to be downhearted. And as we work and as we pray and as we act and as we live, as that Marcus mission says, to strive and safeguard the integrity of creation and to sustain and renew the life of the earth. Let's pray for it, work for it, live for it. Because, as the psalmist says, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And that actually gives us no choice. Amen.
Hear our cry, O King of heaven, Jesus, hope to every heart. We are lost without your glory. We are lost without you, God. Be the fire that burns within us, flames of love that purify. Send your power and your salvation. Let us see your kingdom come. 'Cause only you can move the mountains. Only you can heal our land. Christ alone, our hope and glory. Christ alone, in you we stand. Turn your eyes and show us mercy. How we need the Father's love. Lead us home and out of darkness with your gospel burning bright. 'Cause only you can move the mountains, only you can heal our land. Christ alone, our hope and glory. Christ alone, in you we stand. 'Cause only you can move the mountains, only you can heal our land.
Service today has a theme around creation and our stewardship of it. The psalm we read gives a snapshot of how God went about constructing the earth so that it all worked together to sustain itself. And Colossians reminds us that the whole creation has been redeemed by Christ, not just the human beings. Lord, we just want to marvel at the wonder of creation and thank you for placing us at the centre of such a wonderful world. Everywhere we look, we see signs of your handiwork and the magnificence of your master plan. But we also see how we have managed to unbalance and wreck so much of the natural world, either through our greed or our arrogance that we know better how to make creation work. Lord, will you forgive us and lead us into better understanding? Will you help us as we try to be more sensible in how we use resources? And particularly, we pray for governments and rulers to be willing to change direction. We are so sorry it has come to this, Lord. But you are the God of second chances. And as we survey the mounting devastation, Lord, open our eyes and change our hearts. You are the God of the impossible. And we pray now as the world begins to put the brakes on for the impossible to happen. Lord, will you please be at work in us as nations gather at the G7 in Carbis Bay and COP26 in Glasgow later this year. Speak into the hearts and minds of the world leaders to bring a will for change. Lord, we look to you as Lord of creation to direct us forward. Amen. And now a blessing for ourselves and those we care about and those we struggle with. And this just shows how creation points us to look to God. May the blessing of light be on you, light without and light within. May the blessed sunlight shine on you like a great peat fire, so that stranger and friend may come and warm himself at it. And may light shine out of the two eyes of you, like a candle set in the window of a house, bidding the wanderer come in out of the storm. And may the blessing of the rain be on you. May it beat upon your spirit and wash it fair and clean, and leave there a shining pool where the blue of heaven shines, and sometimes a star. And may the blessing of the earth be on you, soft under your feet as you pass along the roads, soft under you as you lie out on it, tired at the end of day. And may it rest easy over you when at last you lie out under it. May it rest so lightly over you that your soul may be out from under it quickly, up and off on its way to God. And may thou the Lord bless you, and bless you kindly. Amen.
Thank you, Peter, for that challenging talk, and Janet for those lovely prayers as well. And thank you all for joining us throughout our service. And I hope you've found it uplifting and inspiring and challenging, and kind of want to go away and reflect on what you've heard. Well, as I say, we're dedicating the whole day to this. So our live lunch today at 1 o'clock, if you're watching this on Wednesday morning live, then at 1 o'clock today, we've got Dr. Ruth Valerio as part of our panel, along with Peter, who's going to be part of the panel. So you can quiz him on his sermon there if you'd like to. And Ruth Valerio is the Global Advocacy and Influencing Director for Tear Fund. And he's a huge kind of person who's wanting to bring back change in this area, who's wanting to highlight what the issues are. And so we're delighted that she's joining us. And we also have Chrissy Pepper as well, who's the Church and Community Link Officer for Hereford Diocese and does an awful lot of work encouraging churches in this county and Shropshire to be involved and to make a difference in this area as well. So do join us, sign up If you haven't already, just go to bit.ly/SBSJLunch. That's bit.ly/SBSJLunch, and that will take you to the link, our Eventbrite page, where you can then sign up for today's session. It will send you the Zoom link to take part. And it's only half an hour long and it's free, so don't miss it. The first one was brilliant and I'm really looking forward to this next one. Other stuff going on then is we've got the usual kids service going out Saturday morning, and then on Sunday, remember during Lent, we're doing coffee and chat before the service at 9:30. So that's bit.ly/SBSJ coffee, SBSJ coffee. If you want to come and join us, it's been really lovely over these weeks to kind of get to meet some new people that have been watching us online, engaging with us. It's been great to see you and get to know you as well. So if you are new watching this, please do come along and join us. We'd love to meet you. And then after the service, during the service, we'll be continuing the Exploring Prayer series with Archbishop Justin, and Elliot's going to be leading us through. And then after that will be the opportunity again, using that same link, SBSJ Coffee, to explore faith, to talk about what we've heard from the Archbishop, and an opportunity for prayer as well, if you would like that. Last night we started our own prayer course, the Prayer Course Part 2, which is a great course done by Pete Gregg and the team down at HDB in London. And if you missed it and want to sign up, please do get in touch. So there's loads going on as normal. And just to, as we keep saying this every service, but the best way is to sign up to our weekly emails, because that way you'll have all of the links for what's going on rather than you having to try and find them. And if you, so just go on our website, the links are at the bottom of the page, just, and you can fill that in, and then you'll be getting our weekly emails. And I did a little reflection for the start of this week's, which is all about, again, the topic that we've heard today. So I'm going to close our service now with the reading that Peter was referring to from Colossians. And then after that, we shall have our closing song, which was by Sophie Allen, who did this for us right almost about 10 months ago now, towards the beginning of this lockdown, called Jesus is King. So this second reading is from Colossians. Chapter 1, verses 15 to 23. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behaviour, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel, this is the gospel that you have heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you for all that you have done for us in Jesus. Help us to cling on to that hope. And help us to just to stay firm, to keep going, to persevere, to bring your kingdom down, as Peter said. Lord, help us to care for this beautiful earth that you created. Help us to remember all of those global issues around our world, in those small decisions that we make here in England. And as we go about this week, Lord, just pray that we may know your presence with us. Send your Spirit to be upon us. Use us for your glory and your fame, we pray. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.